Jesus is my Savior.
Yes, he is.
My great physician.
Praise the Lord.
Jesus is my Savior.
Yes, he is.
My great physician.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Okay. So God's ways are not our ways. God's ways are not our ways. God's ways are not your ways. Sometimes it could be a coincidence that your ways are the same as God's ways, but not always shall it be so. Always God's will prevails. That's the word for today. It's from Judges. You see Gideon, the man of God, who was very obedient. The first character of Gideon is obedience. He followed every step that God told him to follow. When they were fighting the Amalekites and the Midianites. Yes. Now, Gideon, the strategy for the war in those days is the more the army that you have, you're likely to win, right? Because you're thinking multitudes will win, right? Majority wins. That's why you guys, when you vote, you go by a simple majority. But God does not go with majority. God can work with one person, if possible, half or a quarter of a person, and it still happen. And if the person refuses, he said he's going to use a rock to do it anyway. So he does not need the army anyway. And so it goes back to service. If you don't want to serve, God's going to use a rock. So God decided, when the Israelites were confronting the Midianites and the Amalekites who had joined hands to fight Israel, and that's the same thing that's happening right now. Israel is being fought by several nations. So the story is still going on. So the army of the Midianites and the Amalekites were good in stature. They were big, they are huge, they are well-trained, experienced, and many. So Gideon decided to bring how many men? 20,000. 20,000 men. God said, too many. I don't need that. Let's reduce them. So he reduced them to 10,000 using his own method. God said, no. Still too many. Let me help you out. Go by the water and tell them to drink. Those who gonna, use lap down and use their hands to drink, those are the ones that you choose. And those were how many? 300. My math, simple math tells me from 20,000 to 300, well, that's not even a fraction. You see, God does not work with numbers. God does not work with numbers. So don't give God a formula, A plus B equals to C, for him to bless you.
Thank you.
Put it in the hands of God. Leave it in the hands of God. And he's going to do it in his own ways. Okay? Now, the main thing here to know God's ways is for you to try and understand him. Why do I say try and understand him? Because however much you try to understand God, you're not going to make it, right? But try your best to know his ways. Because then you're going to know his will. And then you go by his will. And then you're going to win. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, if God was small enough to be understood, he will not be big enough to be worshipped. If all of us would have understood God, then why worship him? Because you are at the same level, right? So, God stays sovereign because he cannot be understood completely by us. And that's good because it makes him sovereign, makes him to be worshipped by us. We become his subjects. God is ever moving and dynamic, as much as he's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. He's the same today, yesterday, and forevermore. Yet he is dynamic. The way he blessed you yesterday, he's not going to use the same method to bless you today. The way he blessed my brother Charles, it's not going to be the same way he's going to bless me. He might use the same way, but it's not a must. He can use to choose a different way to bless me, right? So don't be jealous. Don't be jealous. And by the way, the blessing that will come to you might take a shorter time than what it happened to the other person. So that's all because God is dynamic. Blessed is the one who fears the Lord and who walks in his ways. And that's Psalms 128 verse 1. So, point number one, God does not work with numbers. Man finds confidence in numbers and multitudes. You see the difference between God's ways and man's ways? Number one, God does not operate in numbers. But for you and me, the more we are, we think the better. See? And you see an example of this church, the number that we are. How many millions are we? It's membership. But look what the Lord has done. He has expanded our territory. That's a very good example that you can see that God does not work with numbers. He does not work with numbers. No, 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 no. You see, my dad's generation and the older generation of my dad, my grandfather, time, they believed that many children, many wives is wealth. So they were working with numbers. So if I have 50 children, then I should be the chief of the village because I have a greater say. On top of that, if I have 200 cattle in my farm, I should, when I speak, everyone should listen because I have numbers. And that's what the same method our politicians use to win. When they discover they are losing, then they resurrect the dead people and you have ghost voters. And it becomes a tyranny of numbers, so they win. But God does not work like that, right? God does not work like that. God can win with a simple minority, while you win with a simple majority. Hallelujah. So, verse 5 to 7, Judges 7. So Gideon took the men down to the water. There the Lord told him, separate those who lap the water with their tongues as a dog laps from those who kneel down to drink. So 300 of them drank from cupped hands, lapping like dogs. All the rest got down on their knees to drink. The Lord said to Gideon, with the 300 men that lapped, I will save you and give you the Midianites into their hands. Let all the others go home. May you not be found among all the others who are told to go home. Right? May you be found in the 300. That's your portion. Tell your neighbor, may you be found in the 300. May you not be found in those who are told, go home. I don't need you here. That's the word of God. Understand God's thoughts to appreciate his ways and you will be victorious. Where you cannot understand him, just trust him.
That's right.
Trust him.
Yes.
Proverbs what? The theme for this church this year. 3:5? Trust in the Lord with all? Amen. In all your? Do what? In all your ways, acknowledge him. Now, you have your own ways, you're acknowledging him, then that means you're getting rid of your ways and you're being subject to God's ways. So in all your ways, acknowledge him. And he will direct your path. That means he will tell you, this is the way I want you to go. God's ways are the best ones. Hallelujah. Amen. Number two, our God is infinite. We are finite. What's the difference? What does that mean? You cannot measure the size of our God, what he can do. He's infinite, immeasurable, but as you are finite. And that's why one day you are born and one day you do what?
Die.
6 foot under, because you are finite. But was God born? Was he born?
No.
How old is God?
No.
You are good in theology. How old is our God? Tell me. Nobody knows the age of God. We need to sing him happy birthday here, yeah, Pastor Lawrence. So that means our God is infinite. We don't know when he was born. And the good news is that our God will not die. Other gods die. And they never resurrect. So they are finite. So, yes, I love this.
Amen.
I love my God because he's infinite.
Yes.
Infinite or infinite. Depends on which school you went. My teacher told me it's infinite. If you say infinite, it's up to you. Revelation 1:8. What does it say? Who knows what Revelation 1:8 says? I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty.
Amen.
I thank God that he does not have a new year name like me, Moses Inyanje Ihachi, or Charles Chuk Soruji, or John Bosco Namwamba. God's name is here. That I would say it's a name because for lack of English, English is limited. God's description is here. He is, who was, who is to come, the Almighty. So, he is infinite. Don't put God in a box. You can't God in a box, that means you are limiting the blessing that should come to you. Follow God's ways, and he's going to bless you even before you pray.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Because our God is not limited. He's infinite. He's not limited. We are limited. That's why you get your salary by the time you get, for those who are doing bi-weekly, by the time the first week ends, you are broke. Because your pocket is finite. But our God is never broke. Don't you love that? Our God is never broke. He always has. The earth is his footstool. Everything in the waters, on earth, in the sky belongs to him.
Amen.
Ask and it shall be given to you. The problem is we don't know how to ask. Like me, the way I used to ask things from my parents, I'm like, Daddy, pay a book. That means, Daddy, give me a book. Like it was, you kept it there, you went to take it. You want it back. So we need to know how to ask, then we get it, because we don't want to miss the mark. Number three, his ways may be painful and uncomfortable. And unfortunately, mostly that's what happens. Mostly God's ways are very painful and very uncomfortable. In fact, most of us, including me, give up the last minute. Say, God, you're taking too long. Why? Why is it that when the other person, even he doesn't go to church, but he wants something, he gets. Me, I pray twice a day. I fast three times a day. Can you fast three times a day?
No.
But you're not answering me. What's wrong? And then we give God ultimatum. If you don't answer me by tomorrow 2 p.m., I'm going to hang up there. Okay, so his ways may be painful and uncomfortable, but he turns it all around for our good. Man always prefers the easy way. Shortcut. Shortcut, shortcut, shortcut. Have you ever seen a rabbit or a... What's the other name for a rabbit? There's a cousin of a rabbit.
A hare.
A hare. How they run when they are chased by, say, a leopard or a lion. They are like this. Random. So we like shortcut. We like to behave like rabbits. We don't want to wait. I want it and I want it now. The easy way. So, God's ways may be painful but uncomfortable. He knows the end from the beginning while we know the now only. And I thank God that He limited us to know only now. Tomorrow is not promised. The next minute is not promised. Now I'm with you here. The next minute you are our president. That's what you want to hear. What I wanted to say is now I'm with you here. The next minute I'll be told you are admitted or you are no more. Right? So tomorrow is not promised, the next minute is not promised. So, and I like it that way, because sometimes if God shows you the future, you will ask Him to kill you now. You don't want to go through the painful process. So, like me, say I want to have, say, a business or tutoring company or something like that. And then the Lord shows me, before that, my friend, I'll have to chop off your hand and squeeze you a little bit. Then you get there. And then after that all, I'll put your hand back on you. So if I hear that, I'll say, God, I just joking. It's God. You know, sometimes I joke. It's good to joke with you now. I'm messing up with you, God. Come on. How do you think I can be a tutor? Come on. Let's try selling cars. You have to give God alternatives because He showed you the future. So it's good that God does not show you the future for your own good. So be happy that your brain is limited to know the future. And sometimes God gives you the gift to prophesy, right? I don't refuse. And such people are living among us. They prophesy to you and they tell you, my friend, you are going far. You'll be dining with kings. And you'll be smiling, but inside you, you are really doubting. You're saying, such people, I don't like meeting them in the morning. Well, look at this one, he's dreaming. So, either way, it's no good, I think, to know the future and just leave it at that. Genesis 50:19. Genesis 50:19. I think I'll flow with the control for this. Genesis 50:19. This is talking about Joseph. It's talking about Joseph. Joseph's brothers decided that there are too many in their homestead, so they should reduce their number by killing one of them, and that should be the baby like me, who is the last one in my family. Sell him out, get some cash, and go watch a movie. If that's what they were doing those days. So, it was painful for Joseph, but at the end, God turned it all around and Joseph became the what? The second in charge, right? So, verse 19. But Joseph said to them, don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then, don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children. And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them. But how was the process by the time Joseph reached there? He was thrown into a pit, number one. Number two, they smeared blood on a coat. Right? And they used that to go and lie to the father that, you see, this is what remained. Three, I'm sure the person who bought him didn't leave Joseph's hand open. He was tied because now he's a slave. When he got there, he was treated as a slave. So the process was painful. And this is why I was saying, if God opened Joseph's eyes before he left home, to see that he will be thrown in a pit, sold, and then went to suffer on the other land, Joseph will have said, let me send my brother and the other, my cousin, let him take the food to the field, not me. But see what was in store for Joseph. Because God's ways are not our ways. And sometimes it can be painful, but it's turned around for your own good. Only believe. Man judges with what he or she can see, but God judges the heart. It's the heart that God looks at. But for us men, what we see. Huh? What we see is what we believe. If we don't see it, then we don't want to believe it. And we, what we see is what we use to judge other men. So, I think you're getting something. Are you getting something here? I hope you're getting something, because this is just the truth. Just the truth on how God works. Okay? All right. So the next example about God's ways being painful is 2 Kings 5, 10 to 14. So you might not like how God works, but sometimes he does use those ways to bless you. And this is talking about Naaman, Naaman who had leprosy. And God favored him from God, using Elisha to heal him. But the way it was done, Naaman didn't like it. So, 2 Kings 5, 10 to 14. Reading from NIV. And Elisha sent a messenger unto him, saying, go and wash in Jordan. How many times?
Seven
times. Why seven? Just, I would have preferred only one. Because by the way, when you have leprosy, you don't want to go near water. It's just like you have wounds and you are dipping yourself in water. It's going to be painful, right? Now here you are told seven times. And your flesh will be restored and you will be cleansed. 11. But Naaman went away angry and said, I thought that he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God. Wave his hand over the spot and cure me of my leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than any of the waters of Israel? Could I wash in them and be cleansed? So he turned and went off in rage. 13. Naaman's servants went to him and said, my father, if the prophet had told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then when he tells you, wash and be cleansed? So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan seven times as the man of God has told him, and his flesh was restored and became clean like that of a young boy. So it's good to hearken to the word of God. You need a blessing, you have to follow the steps, follow the instructions.
Amen.
If you want to give God a formula, it's not gonna work. It won't. Or it's gonna take years and years before it works. God's ways are not your ways. God's ways are not your ways. However, the pain that you should go through, persevere, relax. Your blessing is coming. Because now, you see, Naaman was giving options here. Why Israel? Why can't I go to Damascus and use the rivers there if I must use a river of water? Or why not just stand there and wave your hand and say, be healed, and I be healed. So, the way you want God to do things might not be the way it's going to happen. Now, you just have to believe and trust God that he gonna do it the right way, and it's gonna work fine for you. The Bible says elsewhere, many are there, but the Lord, from some of them, all of them. So why fear? The Lord's gonna deliver you from all of them. By the way, God does not cause afflictions. He only allows them. Right? So don't be mad at God that he allowed this trouble and that pain and this to happen to your life. No, he only allowed them. Because remember when the devil wanted to tempt Job. What happened? He needed to ask permission. He needed to ask permission. And that's what you don't see.
That's right.
Whenever things are coming your way and you are righteous one of God, you are clean, that's the condition. You have to be saved.
Come on now.
You need to be saved for you to get the privileges.
Uh-huh.
Now, I know all of you should be having some Instagram, Facebook, or let me say now for the old people, you have a mail email account, right? Can you send an email account without having? Can you send an email without having an account with Yahoo, with Gmail? You have to get logged in, right? You have to log in. So same things with things of God. You have to log in. What is the password?
Jesus.
Right. And Jesus brought salvation.
Amen.
Without Jesus, no man can see God. He said, I'm the way, the truth, the life, the resurrection to my Father. If you want to enjoy the privileges of God thinking about your case when the devil goes there to ask for permission, you must be saved. If you are not saved, God or Jesus might say, why ask? He's already yours. Do what you please with your property. I'm not the devil's property. You're not the devil's property. In Jesus' name. Amen. So now I'm assuming you guys are logged in. You are saved. So the devil comes to ask for permission. Can I tempt Yvonne? Then Jesus, God will say, if he allows, because sometimes he doesn't allow completely. If he allows, he'll say, okay, you can touch the flesh, but the soul is mine. And you know how Job's story ended. He got the most beautiful children on earth. The camels were outnumbered. The donkeys were so many. Vast land, good harvest. Amen.
Amen.
So, God knows everything that goes around in your life. Don't complain. And this is what I hear people say. God got you. He got you. God got you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He turns things around for you. Number four, the difference between God's way and man's way. God knows the whys while we ask the why. He knows the why. But you keep on asking, why? Why me, God? Why my family? Why my children? Why my car? Those who are dear to their phones. Why my phone? Why should it break? I just bought it. iPhone 6. Why me? Why my house? Why my job? Why my husband? Why my wife? But God knows the why. And that's a huge difference between us and God.
Amen.
Because he sees, he's the Alpha and Omega. He sees the end from the beginning.
Amen.
It's a good thing we don't see the end from the beginning. I told you why. So we ask ourselves why God allows such and bad things to happen. But Job 21:7 says, Job 21:7, it says, why do the wicked live on, growing old and increasing in power? Now someone asking questions, why? They see their children established around them, their offsprings before their eyes, their homes are safe, free from fear, the rod of God is not on them. Their bulls never fail to breed. Their cows calve and do not miscarry. Why, God? But the Bible tells you, what shall it profit a man to do what? To gain the world and lose? So why do you always ask why? You know your destiny is bigger than the present, right?
Amen.
The latter house is greater than the former house. The latter glory is greater than the former glory. So don't be in a situation of asking God why your neighbor is changing cars every 6 months and they are all black ones while you are still surviving with Honda Accord 1999. Don't ask that. Be contented, and God's gonna show his marvelous ways to you, blessing you in your own way. Blessing you in your own way. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Proverbs 24:2 says, do not envy the wicked. Do not desire their company. Don't envy them. Don't desire their company. Because he who is with you is bigger than the one who is in the world. Number five, God's way and man's way, different. God qualifies the unqualified. Man qualifies the qualified. How does man qualify the qualified? You want a job, you have to send those transcripts. You have to send your CV. So then they look at your CV, they see your qualification. Yeah, Harvard, Oxford, yes. Mm-hmm. Three masters, one PhD. Uh-huh. It's currently doing PhD in economics. Ah, in Sanda. Masters in business. Okay, he qualifies. So that's man qualifying you. But God does not qualify you based on papers. He is the creator of papers. Why would he use papers to qualify you? God qualifies you anytime he wants. And you will qualify whatever position you are applying for. See, examples that God calling. Examples of people in the Bible. I have to take. Maybe he's calling and I'm not called yet. I don't want to get God's miscall. Okay, so examples of people who are not qualified in the Bible, but God qualified them and then used them. Isaac was a daydreamer. Jacob was a cheater. You know, there's a program of TV that they talk about cheaters. As Jacob was a cheater, Peter had a temper and denied Christ. And you know, God, Christ has told him, you know, before the cock crows, you're going to deny me how many times? Three. So he was a cheater. Two. He cheated. And then he had high temper and he denied Christ. David had an affair and tried to cover it up with murder by killing the husband. But he was, what does God give an account of David for? What is he known to be? A man? Yet he had an affair. So was he qualified? No. So don't look at yourself and say, hey, I'm not qualified to serve. I have too many sins. I've sinned a lot. I don't have any talent. You have something. God can use you and still say you are a man after his own heart. Amen. So that was David. Noah got drunk. After he got drunk, what did he do? I know. I don't want to say it is abomination. Elisha was suicidal. He ran away from someone and then he decided to go somewhere and stay there and starve and die. So he was suicidal. Jonah ran from God. Paul was a murderer and he was too religious because he was a scholar. Timothy had too many ulcers. Gideon was insecure. Miriam was a gossiper. But still God used her mouth. Martha was a warrior. Thomas was a doubter. He said, unless I see the marks, I will not believe that he has resurrected. Sarah, impatient. I want a child now. When it did not happen, what did Sarah do? She helped God help her. You know, some of you help God to help you. So Sarah helped God to help her by getting her maid to sleep with her husband to get a child. And you know what happened to that child that was gotten? Became trouble. And according to Pastor Lawrence, he'll give you the history if you ask him. He'll tell you what that child did after that and which nations were created by that child presently. Because he knows a lot of history. I thank God for you, Pastor. Okay, that was Sarah. Elijah was moody. Rahab was a prostitute. Samson, he liked prostitutes. Isaiah, what did Isaiah do? He preached naked for 3 years. Naked for 3 years. Isaiah, Prophet Isaiah, yes, he preached naked for 3 years. Who can do that for 10 minutes? I guess you'll get a crowd, yes, but 3 years. Probably 3 years people get used to you and see nothing. But he preached naked for 3 years. 3 years. Some of you will say, oh, tufiakwa, abomination. Abomination. God forbid. He's not a servant of God. John the Baptist ate bugs. He ate insects, locusts, and had second thoughts about the very Messiah he baptized. Are you the Messiah that was prophesied? That's the question John was asking. He doubted too. So he was a doubting Thomas John. Jeremiah was way too emotional. Moses was a stammerer. And so it doesn't matter the weaknesses that you have. He's going to use you. Because God's ways are not your ways. He qualifies the unqualified. God qualifies the unqualified. God qualifies the unqualified. And I'm a testimony of that. I would give myself that. That's my testimony. Anyway, let it be. And then Zacchaeus was too short. Too short. He had to go up the tree. But he got a chance to dine with Jesus himself. And Abraham was too old. According to biology, nothing would happen. But they got a son. Can you see that? And at the end of it all, Abraham was nicknamed to be the father of faith. So you see, God's ways are not our ways, and he can do anything, anytime, at any age, any place, anywhere.
Amen. Amen.
In his own ways, because he's a dynamic God, Amen. Not limited.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Number 6, God's timing is the best, and that's very painful because I don't like waiting. God's timing is the best, man's timing is a test. That's according to Moses, the book of Moses. God's timing is the best, man's timing is a test. Try to meet a man, an African man on Coffee Call or Starbucks, and you know that man's timing is a test. You told them to, let's meet at 12. Put an error of 3 hours. The man will show up and smile. Nothing has happened. He's not late. He's very early. And you should not complain. Because I came anyway. So man's timing is a test, but God's timing is the best. So God never comes late. God never comes early. Right time. The test is, are you patient? And I came to understand that Americans are the most impatient people. If you want to see that, wait on the lights, and you will know. It changes green, people have sped off. You are not even checking to see if an ambulance is coming from this side or a police siren is coming from this side, because currently your music is turned high. You can't even hear the sirens. So they just speed off, very impatient. So I thank God that God is not an African, so he doesn't come on African time. And he's not an American, so he doesn't come on American time. I thank God that he's God. He is God, and he comes on his God's time. Bible gives you an example of someone who was very American. This guy was called Saul. Saul was supposed to go fight the Philistines. And this is going to be in, well, let me see, 1 Samuel 13, 11 to 13. Saul was supposed to go fight. The tradition was that they give a sacrifice to God, then they go to the battle. But who was supposed to do it? Saul is not the priest, so protocol should be followed. Samuel is the priest. So Samuel delayed to come and offer the sacrifice. And Saul had already assembled the army. Come, 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 warm up, warm up. Going to fight. The army and Saul stood there. They stood there. The old man is not coming. Samuel, who is representing God. So Saul said, because he felt that he's disappointing his army, the army were walking away. So he felt he's losing. So he took the lamp and swatted quickly. Smoke up. Finished. The moment he's finished like this, barely an hour, Samuel walks in. What's wrong with you? Why did you do it? You are not God. Are you God? You should have waited. They lost. We should wait. Wait on the Lord, because God's timing is the best.
Amen.
Saul, 1 Samuel 13:11-13 says, Saul replied, when I saw that the men were scattering, and that you did not come at the set time, and that the Philistines were assembling at Michmash, I thought, now the Philistines will come down against me at Gilgal, and I have not sought the Lord's favor. That means I've not sacrificed. So I felt compelled. I was pushed. I felt compelled to offer a burnt offering. Did you scare too? I felt compelled. I was pushed. I'm putting in some Kiswahili so that you think I'm speaking in tongues, but it's just Swahili. I was pushed to give the offering. So Samuel said, you have sinned. You have sinned, you missed the mark. You are not patient. Wait on the Lord. The other guy that didn't wait for the Lord is Moses. Not me, Moses of the Bible. Don't look at me like that. So Exodus 2:11-25. Here you get Moses who was walking around the place, the palace or the place, and he found an Egyptian fighting a Hebrew. And you know Moses was a Hebrew, right? Moses was born and his birth was destined to come and save the Egyptians. So Moses saw an Egyptian fighting the Hebrew, a fellow friend, a brother. So he killed the Egyptian, right? Did he bury him himself? Whatever happened, he killed him. So he tried to save the Hebrew. Then the next day, he went out and found out that his two brothers, two Hebrews, fighting. And he tried to separate them. The other Hebrew said, hey, where? That means you. You're trying to kill me the way you killed the Egyptian yesterday? Moses had that, he knew the word has spread around and soon it's gonna reach Pharaoh. Moses did what I do best, because I'm Kenyan. He ran, took off, and sat somewhere at the borehole, and some seven girls came who happened to belong to, those are the girls of Jethro. The other name of Jethro is Raul. And then he attended to the camels, and the girls took the report home, and Moses ended up being a herdsman, looking after cattle from the king's palace to being a herdsman. So that's how you lose your grace. If God designed you to do something, wait for God's time. Moses tried to help God before his time. The time to rescue the Israelites or the Hebrews had not come. But Moses did it way earlier. It didn't work. So he lost his position from the palace back to a herdsman, and he had to look after cattle and feed them. So he lost the privileges, lost the mark. So do not help God help you. Do not play God. You are not God. You are a human being. Amen. Wait for God, and he's going to show up and bless you in his own good way. Now, the best example that we have in the Bible is our own daddy, our own brother, our friend. Who is our friend? Jesus. Jesus was on the cross. Jesus was on the cross, almost dying. And these guys were happy and saying, if you are the Son of God, why can't you do what? Save yourself, calm down, come on, you can do it. But Jesus knew that's not the way of God. He knew that. If he wanted, he would have just said, and everyone else dead, except Mary Magdalene and a few women who were crying there. But he didn't, because he knew God's way. You should know God's way. How do you know God's way? Read the word. Listen to Christian music. Not Beyonce. 50 cents. Or Hangla. And those other type of songs. Because out of the fullness of your heart, it's what comes out of your mouth. In computer science, say garbage in, garbage out. Gigo, G-I-G-O. You put garbage in, garbage gonna come out. So Jesus didn't have garbage in. He had the good stuff. God's word, God's way. So he didn't rescue himself. Time came and Jesus was feeling like he's now tired and needs to give up. He said, Father, if possible, let this cup pass. But let your will be done. And the will here is the way. Let your way be done. Let your method be followed. Not my method. Okay? So, and that's how we got salvation. He died on the cross. We got saved. If Jesus would have given up when he felt pain, no one of us here would be in the church. There would be no reason going to church because then there's no salvation, no reason to believe. But he chose to die on the cross for our own sins. But the good news is that he didn't stay in the grave. He resurrected. And he's a living God. Hallelujah. We thank God for all that. I hope you've been blessed about God's ways and our ways. So know how to redirect your thoughts and follow God's ways, because that's the only way you are going to be saved and you receive the good things you need to receive to survive on this earth. Mostly, God's way is salvation. If you don't have salvation, you need it. And the time is now, not tomorrow. So I'm going to pray.
Jesus says,
Jesus is my Savior, He is my Redeemer,
my great physician.
Praise the Lord,
Jesus is my Savior.
Yes, He is.